Welcome to Bible Truths. Today's lesson is titled, A Survey of the Book of Romans. I'd like to start off by reading from the book of Romans in chapter 1, verse 16, which suggests the theme of the book. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also the Greek. Now the gospel of Christ is the message, it's the good news, and how a person can be saved or right with God. That information is located in the Bible, and more specifically, it's located in the New Testament. And it's for everyone who believes, not only the Jew, but also the Greek, or Gentiles. Now here, Gentiles or Greek is everyone who isn't a Jew, and it's for everyone who believes. In fact, the reason this book was written is because there was a misunderstanding among some of the Jewish Christians of the idea that a person needed to become a Jew first or to become circumcised in order to become a Christian first. But that is not true. This book has a series of arguments which tells us that the Gentiles are just as acceptable as the Jewish Christians are. So this book is a deep book, and sometimes people get lost in the details. And so sometimes people have misunderstandings about the book and teach false ideas out of it. Things like, there's nothing good in a person, or we inherit Adam's sin, or the idea that we can just confess Jesus as our Lord and Savior and that we're saved. And sometimes people go to Romans 14 to justify sin. And when it's in context, it's about freedoms in Christ. So therefore, setting the context in the book of Romans is important. Let's go to Romans chapter 1, verse 1 and start doing that. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. This is identifying Paul as the author of this letter. Jumping down to verse 5, through whom we have received grace and apostleship. It's saying that Paul was picked by Jesus to be an apostle. For what reason? For the obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ. To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints. So here we have a passage of Scripture that stresses the obedience to the faith among who? All nations, Jew and Gentiles. And it's written to saints, or that's just another term for Christians. Let's read verses 16 again. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also to the Greek. Let's read verse 17. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. In it, the righteousness, that is, that's speaking about the gospel, the New Testament specifically. And it's identifying faith as important here. Faith is the idea of trusting in God enough to do what he says. Now the next section is speaking about the idea that there's a problem, that all sin and all are justly condemned because we sin. Let's start reading verse 18 through 21. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest in them. For God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God. In other words, God reveals things in nature that we can know that there's a God and that he has a will for them. Let's drop down to verse 24. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator. Here God gave up those people who rejected God and he let them sin. And it goes on in this rest of this chapter to talk about certain sins like sexual immorality, being deceitful, being disobedient to parents. And then in chapter 2, we have how people are going to be judged. Let's read in verse 2. But we know that the judgment of God is according to truth against those who practice such things. So God judges according to truth. Now let's look at verse 4. Or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? In other words, God blesses us so much that when we know there's a God, we need to repent because he's so good to us. And verse 5, but in accordance with your hardness and your impenitent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Those who won't repent of their sins will be judged by God. Verse 6, and this is how he judges, who will render to each one according to his deeds, in other words, what he does, eternal life to those who by patient continuance in doing good seek for glory, honor, and immortality. But to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first, and also the Greek. Now you'll see that argument on occasion, the Jew first and the Greek also, speaking of all people, saying that all people are acceptable to him, those who are based on if they do what's right. Verse 10, continuing, but glory and honor and peace to everyone who works what is good, to the Jew first and also the Greek. For there is no partiality with God. In other words, God doesn't show biasness towards any group of people. Dropping down to verse 14. For when Gentiles who do not have the law, that is the law of Moses, by nature do the things contained in the law, these, although not having the law, are law to themselves, who show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and between themselves their thoughts, accusing or excusing them in the day when God will judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ, according to my gospel. So here we have a passage of scripture that talks about, first of all people are going to be judged by what they do, and are also going to judge by the gospel of Christ. In addition, it says the Gentiles who didn't have the law of Moses did by nature what was contained in the law, which disproves that the idea that person is, there's nothing good in a person. Now dropping down to verse 23, where it speaks about the Jews. You who make your boast in the law, do you dishonor God through breaking the law? So you see, the Jews thought they were really special because they were God's chosen people, not because they did well in keeping the law. Verse 24, for the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you, as it is written, for circumcision is indeed profitable if you keep the law. But if you are a breaker of the law, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. Under the law of Moses, circumcision was a requirement. And therefore, Jews would be circumcised and Gentiles would not be. Continuing on, verse 26. Therefore, if an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the law, will not his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? And will not the physically uncircumcised, if he fulfills the law, judge you, who even with your written code and circumcision are a transgressor of the law? In other words, the Gentiles did by what nature what was contained in the law. But on the other hand, the Jews had the law of Moses, and yet they failed to keep the law. And so the end of this discussion is summed up well in chapter 3, verse 9. What then? Are we better than they? Not at all. For we have previously charged both Jews and Greeks. They are all under sin. In other words, both sin, so both are condemned. Then in chapter 3, verse 21, we have the remedy for sin. That is the gospel of Christ. And it runs all the way through chapter 5, verse 21. And basically we have in verse 21 through 31 the basic ideas that first of all, the gospel was witnessed by the Old Testament, and that all men sin and fall short of the glory of God, and also the idea that God, Jesus, died for our sins, and that we're justified by faith. And then in chapter 4, we have a great example of Abraham and how his faith is upheld as something to follow. In verse 12, it sums it up well. Speaking of Abraham, who walks in the steps of faith. In other words, he did what God said to do. Now in verse 13, we have a statement that talks about the idea that the promise of eternal life was not through the law of Moses, but through the promise to Abraham. Let's read verse 13. For the promise that he would be heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Verse 16, therefore it is of faith that it might be according to grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all, as is written, I have made you a father of many nations. And he's quoting from Genesis chapter 17, verse 4, and he became the father of many nations because of his obedience to what God said to do. And then in chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, it draws another conclusion. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we, that is Christians, have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace. In other words, we have access by faith into this grace because grace is the idea of it's unmerited favor. In other words, nothing that we can do deserves it. And so, in chapter 5, further on, in verses 6 through 11, it talks about the specialness of Christ's sacrifice for our sins. And in chapter 5, verse 12, it begins a discussion between what Adam did and what Christ did. And let's read verse 12. Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men. Why? Because all sin. It's not because we inherit sin. It's because we sin just like Adam sinned. And so therefore we're deserving death. And then the rest of chapter 5 speaks about the idea that the grace of God is stronger than sin. In other words, we need Christ's sacrifice for our sins so that we might have a hope to be right with Him. Okay, and since we realize that, in chapter 6, we have the start of the idea that since the gospel is rendering for sin, we need to repent of our sins. Let's read verse 1, starting. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Jesus, Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Here we have a section of scripture that talks about, now that we're Christians, we need to get our life right with God. We need to make sure that we repent of our sins. That's what he says in verses 1 and 2. How shall we, that is Christians who died to sin, live any longer in it? And then he goes on and talks about being baptized into Christ, and he connects baptism with the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for our sins. And then he talks about, well, since we've done that and Christ died for us, that how can we be slaves of sin anymore? And then the contrast in that is in verse 22, where he says, "But now, having been set free from sin and having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness and the end, everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Here he says that we now, instead of being slaves of sin, we need to be slaves of God. And he says, the end of that, if we do that, is eternal life. In verse 23 again, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." So it's important to be obedient to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In chapter 7, verses 1 through 6, we have an analogy where it says basically the idea that the Jews are now dead to the law of Moses, and now they're free to become Christians. In verses 7 through 16, it talks about the idea of how important the law of Moses is, how it made sin apparent, for instance. And then the rest of the chapter talks about the Apostle Paul's struggle with sin, the lust of the flesh, and struggling with his mind to control himself so that he doesn't sin. So we have a conclusion in chapter 8, verse 1. "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit." So here we have a passage of Scripture that basically says that we need to be in Christ and that we don't walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. What this passage is saying, is not saying, is the idea that the Holy Spirit forces us to walk according to Christ. No, that we with our minds voluntarily do what the Holy Spirit teaches as revealed in the Gospel or the New Testament. And then in verses 12 and 13, it talks about the idea of being debtors to keeping the law of Christ. And then in the end of the chapter, it talks about those who are obedient to Christ, those who love God, that if we do that, that no one can take this salvation away from us. Only us, if we're not obedient. And then in chapter 9 and through chapter 11, it talks about how the gospel relates to Israel. In chapter 9, it talks about those who have faith or are spiritually minded. Those are Christians. And that is the true, those who are really the Israel today. And he's not talking about literally fleshly Israel. And then at the end of the chapter 9, starting in verse 30, we have what the problem of Israel was, the Jews. "What shall we say then? That the Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith. But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were, by the works of the law, that is, the law of Moses. For they stumbled at that stumbling stone, as it is written, 'Behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame.'" In other words, when Christ came to die for our sins, the Jews rejected him. They wouldn't confess Jesus as their Lord and Savior. In chapter 10, we have that highlighted, starting in verse 9. Let's read that. "That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes to righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation. For the Scripture says, 'Whoever believes on him will not be put to shame.' For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The idea here is that the Jews would not confess Jesus as our Lord and Savior. What he's not teaching here is that we just confess Jesus as our Lord and Savior and that we'll be saved and we'll be right with him. No, that's not what he's talking about. In verse 19, he goes on and says this, that the Jews should have known these things in verse 19 to the end of the chapter. But I say, did Israel not know? First Moses says, I will provoke you to jealousy by those who are not a nation. I will anger you by a foolish nation.
But Isaiah
is very bold and says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I was made manifest to those who did not ask for me. But to Israel he says, all day long I have stretched out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. So the scripture says that the Jews should have known better, and he made himself manifest to those who didn't know him. In other words, the Gentiles. And then in chapter 11, we have this conclusion saying, in verse 1, I say then, has God cast away his people? Certainly not. For I am also an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. So here we have the Apostle Paul saying, no, God didn't cast away his people because I'm a Jew. I'm Christian also, and I'm a Jew. And then he goes on in chapter 11 and says that basically we need to become obedient to God, be faithful to him. And then realizing these things, now that the gospel has been shown to all people, both Jew and Gentiles, the scripture starts talking about making application under the law of Christ or the gospel as revealed in the New Testament. Let's read chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. It's reasonable to put God first, make it a living sacrifice. Christians are supposed to do that. In verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world. In other words, don't be like the world. Be like what God wants us to be. And he says how to do that. Going on, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. In other words, we transform our mind by doing what God says as revealed in the gospel, the New Testament. And that we prove it from the scriptures what God's will is. We don't take somebody's word for it. We do that. We prove it for ourselves. And we have our own faith. And in verse 3, he talks about how Christians are supposed to be humble. In verses 4 through 16, he talks about a Christian's obligations to the church. In verses 17 through 21, it talks about vengeance is God's responsibility. It's not Christians. A Christian cannot take vengeance for himself. And then in chapter 13, verses 1 through 7, it talks about a Christian's responsibility to obey the civil government. In verses 8 through 14, it talks about our responsibility to our neighbors, to love them. And then in chapter 14, and starting in verse 1 through chapter 15, verse 7, we have what's spoken about as Christian liberties, where the context here is the food laws and customs in the law of Moses. Now that, and what this passage is speaking about is now that the Jewish Christians are free from the law of Moses, they don't have to follow these laws anymore. In fact, it says that in verse 21, that we're not to try to force the Jewish Christians to believe that they don't have to do these things anymore because they've lived it all their lives. They may have trouble with it. So in verse 21, he says this, it is good neither to eat meat nor drink wine or do anything by which your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. And then verse 23 says, but he who doubts is condemned if he eats because he does not eat from faith. For whatever is not from faith is sin. The specific application is between right and wrong. We need to do what we think is right. And we shouldn't try to force somebody not to do that. And then we have in chapter 15 the idea of that Christ ministers to both Jew and Gentile. And then in chapter 16, we have the idea of the final greetings and exhortations of Paul to Christians. And starting verse 17, "Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learn, and avoid them. For those who are such do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple." Here's a warning about false teachers and how we can recognize that they are partly, at least by their smooth words and flattering speech. And then at the end of the chapter, in verses 25 and 26, we have a final exhortation. He says, "But now to him who is able to establish you, that is Jesus, according to my gospel, and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now has been made manifest, and by the prophetic scriptures has been made known to all the nations, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, for the obedience to the faith." It's very important to be obedient to God. Now, the book of Romans is not specifically written to show people how to become Christians, but you can argue it from the book of Romans. In Romans 6, verses 1 through 4, it teaches the idea that repentance and baptism is important so that we can have forgiveness of sins. And in Romans 10, 9 and 10, it talks about the idea of belief and confession. I'd like to thank you for listening today, and I invite you to listen again.